There is a memory, the first awareness in my life, of bees and butterflies in a jungle that towered above me. The jungle's endless, green branches in a maze that is impenetrable. Exotic reds and blues. There's grass. In some far distance, there are shadowy grey walls. A man's voice sings in the distance also. All memory is grist to the fiction writer's mill. The pleasure and the pain experienced by any storyteller's characters. The euphoria of happiness. The ache of grief must, of course, be the storyteller's own. It cannot be otherwise. And in that sense, all fiction has its autobiographical roots, spreading through, in my case, a provincial world, limited and claustrophobic. I was born in this house, in the small town of Mitchelstown in County Cork, famous for its martyrs and its processed cheese, cut down to size by its surrounding mountains. A squat little town, looking as though someone has sat on it. Mitchelstown today is doing nicely. A good business town, as my father used to say, knowing about such matters. I'm glad it's doing nicely. I owe it a debt.
Yes, I would, yes. I was only three, I think, or something like that. When we left,
that's right.
We went down to York.
We went to the...
Yeah.
Right, and we York. Just go to York every summer. So nice to meet you down there as well.
Yes. Good, good.
So it's this small world.
Yes. Then we moved on to...
The town, this one and others, taken for granted in childhood, the town is a place where people are, became my writer's model, a microcosm to work with, to transform into an institution or a congregation, a family, a household, a temporary gathering of strangers. Raised in provincialism, I'm a provincial still. The small towns of Ireland are what I know best and turn to first to find my bearings.
The days of the pony and trap.
Yes, yes, yes. Well, of course, it used to be much sleepier.
Oh, it was. Well, the population has gone up, of course.
What is the population of Mitchelstown now?
It's about 3,500, the town itself, whereas the hinterland in would make it up to about 6.
Yes, 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 that's right.
But there's only one main industry here, and that's basically the creamery and the bacon factory.
And the bacon factory,
the
yes.
The bacon factory.
Yeah.
As she cycled back to the hills on a Friday, Bridie often felt that her friends in the town truly envied her her life. And she found it surprising that they should do so. If it hadn't been for her crippled father, she'd have wanted to work in the town also. In the tinned meat factory or in a shop. In the evenings, sitting with her father in the farmhouse, she often thought about the town, imagining the windows lit up to display their goods and the sweet shops still open so that people could purchase chocolates or fruit to take with them to the cinema. But the town was 11 miles away, which was too far to cycle there and back for an evening's entertainment. When he'd listened to the news, her father read a Wild West novel. And Bridie washed the eggs she'd collected.
Youghal, where next I lived, stands up for itself. Youghal is gracious and elegant and fun. It's a town that no one could dislike, mildly fashionable as a watering place in my childhood, softly charming now.
Youghal, Roach said, I was born in Youghal in County Cork, he told the two ladies. In 1934, my mother went in for a swim and got caught up with the current. My father went in to fetch her, and they both went down. Memories are extraordinary. The things you'd remember and the things you wouldn't. Near the lighthouse in Youghal, there's a shop I used to buy rainbow toffees in.
Sir Walter Raleigh lived here. The yew tree thrives. There's a hint of boarding house blues about the seaside architecture that stirs the curiosity. What secrets are locked away behind that tapestry of fascinating windows? What thoughts and voices occupy those rooms?
The houses were color washed in pink or cream, in yellow, gray, or blue. Their hall doors painted in some contrasting shade, or grained. A cat crept along the grey pavement, interested in the empty bottles outside each door. Windows stared.
Sharon Tam has developed a fantasy about you, she said. She imagines she's in love with you. He drank a mouthful of his drink and then another. He didn't say anything. Nor did she. Have you hated me all these years? She asked eventually, not knowing what else to say.
Somewhere in the house, he could hear the heavy tread of Guard Foley. The smell of frying rashers and the chatty voice of a radio disc jockey drifted into the kitchen. Mr. Condon, called Thomasina McCarthy. Mr. Condon, Mrs. Keane has the breakfast ready.
Her aunt's house reflected the person she was. Neat as a new pin, full of light, the windows of its small rooms invariably open at the top to let in fresh air. Her aunt had a fear of dankness, of damp clothes and wet feet and rain falling on the head.
In the dining room, my mother laid the table with knives and forks and side plates. My father said, a meal had been fried for me and had sat in the oven until it was burnt. 6:30 was the hour for eating, he said. Were you drinking? My father asked with a dangerous note in his voice. Is that where you were, drinking? I said Frau Messenger had died, but I don't think they heard.
Quigley said that one night he looked through a window and saw the Protestant clergyman, the Reverend Johnson, lying on the floor with his wife.
The summer crowds have not yet arrived. It's chilly on the Strand, among the remains of the old breakwaters, the promenades waiting for the sun.
Only a few strode through the breeze on the promenade, but soon there would be others. Bookmakers and publicans, insurance salesmen, commercial travellers, wives and children, all returning at 5:30 to the boarding houses. The regulars were there today. Summer and winter, spring and autumn, Miss Laffan the dressmaker was seen on the seafront every Sunday evening. Mr. O'Hagan from the post office walked the length of the promenade every day of his life.
The memory lane that winds through the little towns of Ireland has its bundles of personal riches. There is that sound, most evocative of all, that will accompany you forever on all your journeys. There is the smell of turf smoke on the damp town air, quite different from turf smoke in the countryside. A man shot himself near here. His life was hell, people said. Why was it hell? What did it mean, hell? My eavesdropping told me nothing. No one would answer my questions. He was a man I'd seen, who'd spoken to me, who'd called me boy and laddie.
She didn't tell you he took his life. The old woman crossed herself, her gesture as swift as it always was when she made it. She continued to pour her stout, expertly draining it down the side of her glass.
No,
he replied.
She didn't tell me that.
Well, I'll tell you now. When Ariadne was 10 years old, her father took his life. Shame is the state Ariadne lives in.
They talk about hurling matches and mackerel catches. They gossip. They seriously discuss. There was a man in Youghal once upon a time who did a trick that people loved. He would weigh a bundle of nails in the palm of his hand and then, apparently, eat them. Old Zeb Miller was always good for a glacier mint. Feathery Ike, another man was called, no one knew why. It isn't nostalgia that pulls the fiction writer back into the past. It's his curiosity about the state of childhood and his feeling that what happens in childhood has happened forever.
The Protestant boy, Derek Berthistle, didn't remain in the classroom for the catechism examinations. And he didn't come into prayers either. He waited in the cloakroom. And once, when a girl complained that a pair of scissors was missing from her school bag, Derek Berthistle was sent for by Sister Sullivan because the school bag had been hanging in the cloakroom and he'd been sitting beside it for 3/4 of an hour. But Derek Berthistle hadn't taken the scissors. It turned out in the end that there hadn't been a pair of scissors in the girl's school bag at all. Well, Derek, Father Pierce always said when Derek Berthistle returned to the classroom. Well, Derek, we had a great time with the catechism. Were you all right in the cloakroom?
I was, Father.
Well, that's grand. Joey, will you sing a verse of your song for Derek? So Joey Ferrick sang another verse of The Meeting of the Waters. And when he'd finished, Father Pierce said, There's a terrible old carry-on coming into the town, I hear.
I hope none of you will be begging coppers to spend on the like of that.
They knew he was joking. There was no one better than Father Pierce at pretending he was serious.
Oh, I think there'll be coppers spent all right, Sister Teresa Dolores said.
Beyond Cork City and Bandon and Clonakilty, deep into West Cork, is the town where next I lived. Skibbereen, known then as the Back of Beyond. The journey is one to linger along. Gorse and fuchsia grow well. In pockets here and there, there's a tropical look to the vegetation. The landscape's more dramatic than it is on the other side of the county. Speckled rock surfaces break out in the patchwork of fields. Once upon a time, the country women of West Cork wore strangely hooded cloaks as they walked these roads and lanes or sat in their donkey butts. To this day, on a Sunday usually, the menfolk pitch heavy metal bowls along the same roads, laying wagers and marking the length achieved by each. Young men are heroes for an afternoon. Excitement thunders through a crowd. Strictly speaking, it's all against the law. But there have been so many laws in Ireland that further suppression isn't easy, and holding up the traffic for a minute or two comes naturally. Skibbereen, so its name says, is the place of the little boats, famous for its newspaper and much besides. A cathedral city in today's tourist-conscious Ireland. It always was, of course. But in my day, no one thought to mention it. Instead, there was the journey to school. The brass plates of vets and accountants and doctors squinted up at. Carts rattling by. Tinker women. A smell of whiskey and sawdust drifting out of public houses. Driscoll's sweet shop. Hickey's paper shop. Shannon's bakery, a cafe now.
I don't know actually what their title is. Today he's chief demonstrator, but what's it, a rural food, is it? Yeah, I'm actually a food consultant, whatever that is. I don't know what it is. That's what they call me anyway. And somebody wants to produce a food. I usually set them up from beginning right the way through to making it to marketing it all. You mentioned traveling in Europe. You do that? I do, yeah. I've done, well, I do some work in Egypt as well, and Indonesia.
Yes, sir. Indonesia, and there's nobody else does what I do.
That grey woman still stands where four streets meet, the Maid of Erin, voted by referendum to remain where she is, although she's in the way. E. O'Donovan, undertaker, sold ice cream and chocolate in my day. A pub near here sold coal as well as pints. If you're in business at all, you might as well do it properly.
Tom had never been in a public house before. Men were at the counter, leaning their elbows on it. A few were sitting at tables. Mr. Coyne of the garage was there, and men whom Tom didn't recognize. One person was silent, not saying a thing. The others talked about horses. Lashaway to win. Persian Prince. John Joe Shevlin up. Mr. Fun. Happy Honeymoon, 3 o'clock, Market Raisin. Bat Nolan advised Persian Prince. If there was a young fella that ever sat on the back of a horse with the skill of John Joe, he had yet to be shown him. All animals acquired quality under John Joe. There was talk of the weather as well, and of potatoes and hay. Isn't a pub a great place? Mr. Coyne remarked, and Tom agreed that it was. None better, he said, in a grown-up way.
The child belonged to the town. The fiction writer doesn't. The fiction writer is beyond the pale, outside, looking in. You can't focus from within. The shadows are your place. The limelight's alarming. Eavesdropping's still your business.
You must change partners. If not, I'll be asking you to do a forfeit on the floor. So away we go.
Go marching in.
I've known this house for 50 years and never known it lived in. It wasn't derelict once, just boarded up, a place someone one day intended to return to. But no one ever did, and all my life I've wondered about that. Fantasies began here, a curiosity about the people who might return to occupy an idyll. But because they never did, here you can be a mile beyond the pale, and no one even notices. Here you feel that when all said and done, you belong in solitude. Here the hidden ground of storytelling, the bustle of the town, the streets and noise and schoolroom orderliness acquires perspective. Here, in my favorite part of Ireland, reality is transformed by the escape from it.